A conversation with popular Jamaican radio talk show host Barbara Gloudon. So don't go anywhere. Carib Nation is up next. Carib Nation, I'm David Hinds, coming to you from Kingston, Jamaica. If you come to Jamaica and you listen to the radio, you can't miss Barbara Gloudon. She is a popular radio talk show host, and she's very entertaining, very lively, very controversial, and also very informative. We'll have a conversation today with Ms. Gloudon on a wide range of issues that affect Jamaica and the Caribbean. Ms. Gloudon, welcome to Carib Nation.
Nice seeing you.
Let's get straight to the issues. Many people have been saying over the last 10, 15 years, especially, that the Jamaican society in particular, and the Caribbean society in general, is in crisis. Economic crisis, political crisis, social crisis. Now, that's a heavy statement. What's your take on it?
Interestingly, the Bishop of Jamaica, the Anglican Bishop, preached on this recently, on crisis. And he reminds us that the Chinese said that crisis means two things. It means challenge, and it means something which we have to deal with, which isn't good. And I think that we have worn out the word crisis now, and we should begin to find another word. Because what I regard as far more interesting is that the Caribbean is an evolution, as in Jamaica, a world which is rapidly changing. Nothing that was is. And the question is, what do you do to cope with that thing? That is, where, if it is a crisis, that is the crisis of how do you change with a world which is changing so rapidly. And before you have dealt with one thing, something else, or three other things are with you, where do you go from there? That's where we have to start from.
Yeah, almost 40 years after independence, Jamaican independence. Are you satisfied that Jamaica's lived up to the expectations of 40 years ago?
I don't know what those expectations were. I know that we'd have hoped that we'd have had a country which would have been more self-determined, self-reliant, playing its part in the outer world as for itself. In that respect, no, we haven't done everything that we had to, but who at 40 has lived up to all their expectations? If anybody can remember what they were at 40. Mm-hmm. All right. The point, though, is that we're living in a rapidly changing world. And my concern is, how does Jamaica and other small nation states making up the Caribbean, you're from Ghana, which is a nation. How do you cope with the change? I was reading this week, was it Newsweek, which said that fax machines are becoming obsolete. It's only last week a few people got two fax machines. So that you're playing catch up the whole time. Just as you have set love, look at education. When I was going to school, the obvious goal was to make people literate and numerate. If you could read, write, arithmetic. Now you have to be also technologically educated. So that technological education has a price. It costs money. It costs money which you have to earn here to buy it elsewhere. And so you're playing catch up every time. Five computers does not allow me, but some schools have one. How do you divide the time for that going to do? Well, what do you do in a world of globalization? China has now entered into this great big pact with the United States. Do we begin to understand what that is going to mean to a country which is not primary producers of anything that anybody can do without? Yes, we make the damn best coffee in the world, but if you don't have a cup of coffee, you won't die. You get miserable, but you won't die. We do bauxite. Aluminium is not the number one strategic mineral anymore because there's no war on. We do some agricultural crops, banana and so on. We had the bizarre thing of Costa Rica selling peeled bananas to Jamaica the other day because something was happening to our crops. I don't think it's the easy cut and dried answer because some people keep saying, oh, my country, it is of thee, it should have gone that far. It's not that simple. The question is that there are a lot of things which have to be done. How do you get educated? Educated how, for what and when, at what cost? How do you house your people? What are people's expectations of the good life? What are they prepared to give? How favorable are you to investment? Investment will only come when there's a good life. There's an irony to that, you know. When you're doing well, people are attracted to you. When you're not doing well, they won't come to you. And if they don't come to you, you can't do well. So there is a glass. And I think that in terms of a 40-year challenge, the challenge of moving a small country at the same rapid pace that the rest of the world has to move.
You mentioned globalization. Let's talk a little bit about globalization and its impact on Jamaica. Because it seems to me that one of the repercussions of globalization is a threat to sovereignty.
Yes.
Talk a little bit about that.
There are no borders, and people can come in and out and they can sell what they want. If you go along the streets of Kingston, there are more sellers than buyers. But they are also in Boston, and they're in Bridgetown, and they're in Georgetown, Guyana, and they're in St. Martin, wherever they are. Because if the world has become one big flea market, and in that situation, people are losing what they had. For instance, here they had an exquisite little operation called All Size Hand Embroidery. Exquisite work done by these fine women. But you can get a Chinese operation, print out the same pattern on a stencil with dyes and whatever, create the same thing to look like the same thing. So the women who very meticulously did this fine sewing are now obsolete. The factory closed last week or the week before. So that globalization means that people are being pushed rapidly to change from the old way. And this notion, they don't apologize, is that the small competes with the strong. Here, this country is flooded by old battered pears. Some of them in an ice along that they look like something from the fossil age. But pears and apples and grapes and plums and peaches and nectarines, the what left from the great land. But you have in hell to plant more guavas and pineapples and azola cherry and the things which make for the good life here. Because if somebody can write off an order, send an order off on the internet to say, send me 40 crates of apples, he don't have to worry about planting it, weeding it, pruning it, watering it, paying the workers to do it. He can pick it up. It comes down on the plane the next day. It's issues like that you have to look at, that you train workers in the garment industry. But in Jamaica, the worker's not going to work for $5 and a bowl of rice. He die first. So that what you have is that you have factories going to places where it is cheaper because the Jamaican labor will not work for that kind of wage. And all of this is part of the balancing act. It's not that just, oh, if you are not to people, then why do you rich? It's far more complex than
that. So we need to have like a whole change in the culture,
yes,
people's attitude,
yes,
and so on.
Yes.
And how do you see that working out here in Jamaica? Is it beginning to happen?
In some respects, it's beginning to happen, and in a lot of respects, it has not yet sunk in. That is a change because of the old political paradigm. The party in power took care of these people in power. The party outmarked time till it came back in. It doesn't work that way anymore. People just have to be able to pay their way, get where they're going. And it's very, very hard. In some respects, some people understand, certainly with the young people. There are tremendous training programs through a thing called HEART. There are all kinds of other programs in schools. Young people are being told, look, it's a different world. You have to become mechanized. I use a term of saying to young people, when my father was growing up, he was a great man with cars. You would fly the bonnet and hit the point, and you take the point and scrape it up. Now you have to have a computerized manual to the insides of a car. And this is perhaps the greatest thing to be able to say to the old generation. You see, look at the dilemma. You have an older generation who knew a different way. He knew that when you left school, you got a job with the government service. He don't understand about big government and so much of the gross domestic product is not to be spent on government employment. Scale down government. That's the word that come from outside. But government in colonial times employed more people who came out of school. That avenue is choked up. My father and his generation knew of where he didn't have to pay for his medication at the hospital. He went there and whatever he wanted at the hospital, he got it. Now today in the hospital has to function where it has to have diagnostic equipment. My father never knew that. So you have one older generation who lived through a gentler time when the state was more benign. Things were easy. Things came from England. You know, You live in a new society now which is saying it pays for itself as it doesn't. And you have to do a balancing act. You have to have the young people living in a world of a new imperative, the older people who knew the good old days when.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying?
Right.
And time does not allow you to sit and massage this lot or to say to this lot, hold on while I look about this lot. And this is what is happening. It's like a train coming on a track. And it's coming at you so fast that you don't know where the switch is to move it out.
Do you think Jamaicans really appreciate what they have here in Jamaica, some of the positiveness that
no,
is?
No. And I think that's the saddest thing, the work that I do in radio makes me. And yet there are points of light. There are points of light in that if you look for the stories, you will find them. Of tremendous achievement by young men, working class people, people want to call the ghetto, now call the inner city, who are doing things. working on their own, younger people who are having a vision, but not far and away enough, because remember, the old syndrome is still there. Where the government are do? Where the government are do? Water must come into my village. The water comes, but I don't understand that I don't have to pay for the water, because government has to find the pipe, to find the hardware to get the water, has to get the engineers to do the water. In the old days, we got the water, we never cared about it really. And in the old days, the pipe wasn't in our homes anyway. We went to the standpipe and got it. But now we don't want the standpipe. Right. We want the water in our home. But we have not yet got to the point, I said, who pays for the water to get in our home?
That statement, what government to do, is a statement that we know very much in the Caribbean.
Yeah.
But don't you think that that is conditioned by the attitude of politicians who tell the people that we can do everything for you five-year election
Lord
time? Yes.
And it returns to haunt them.
Right.
It returns to haunt them, because when you go on the hosting, the people say, what you bring for me? What
right.
you going to give me? I will say, though, that in later times, I'm hearing more politicians, particularly the younger ones, saying to people, we can't go that route again.
Mm-hmm.
And in some respects, you see where there's really determined effort. But there's still pockets of the old paternalism and the old, you know, bubble and hand in pocket and, you know, you wash my back and I will wash your mm-hmm. dish or whatever. Not enough of it, but I think that there's a new generation growing. The fearsome thing, I think, though, is that you're growing a group of alienated young people who are totally alienated from politics, who feel that they wish to have no part of it, and that is dangerous.
What are the repercussions of that?
It's dangerous, because if you can have an election where a third of the electorate can't bother to vote, then you're in trouble, or half of the electorate can't vote, because you mean you will leave the process to people who really are not worthy. My anguish sometimes is with young, tertiary trained young people who somehow seem to feel that the country owes them something. I went to the university, here am I, I'm back, what's mine? And there are not enough voices from that corner engaging in the public debate about how we change it. There are some, but in my mind, not enough.
One of the issues that has been affecting Jamaica in a persistent manner over the last 30, 40 years, the issue of violence,
yes.
crime. In tackling crime and violence here in Jamaica, where do you think the emphasis should be placed? Where should the attack point be?
Chicken and its egg. It is obvious things that if you could get an economy turning around to the point, there's more employment, there's more opportunity, particularly for young men. People would not feel impelled to seek criminal solution. And that is a hard one, a long-term one. It's also how you get the community to become part of it.
Mm-hmm.
When Giuliani came down at the Avenging Agent in New York and started roughing it up, and you forget that people are beaten in New York too, and beaten mm-hmm. wherever. What he had to do was to get the community on his side. Some efforts have been made here. There are neighborhood watches. There are what they call community dispute resolution groups. There are groups where people meet with the police. But not everybody does this. There still is a vast fear of the police. People feel that if I give information to the police will get it back and they will take it. I ain't spending no time with the police because I'm an informer. I think crime will be dented when the society decides that it is part of the solution to begin to dent crime. Where does the police get information from? The other day they had a jailbreak. And one of the proudest ones was that three mothers marched the sons back to the jail.
Mm-hmm.
And said, look, we don't want you out here. We don't want you out here because you run the risk of getting shot. And then they took them back to the jail and handed them back over. So that I think that the answer to crime and violence in Jamaica as anywhere is when you have a society which is itself sensitized to its responsibility and role in keeping a safe society. Cybercrime. Cybercrime is in Jamaica. It's not the old days of a man took a breadfruit. There are guns which all the things that you were fighting with the NRP are in coming down here. And when they come, our Minister of Justice met with Janet Reno to say, what can you do about the flow of guns? Well, we're sorry, da 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 da. The guns are coming in. And people have a vested interest in selling the guns here. So you understand? So it's not the fact that if we all went out in the world and fired the minister, there's a big call to fire. Well, fire him. But having fired the minister, you're going to find that the problem is still there. Drug transshipment is a point. We sit right in the middle of the rain with the stuff coming through from Colombia.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah. Don't be simplistic about it. It's not a simple unicellular answer.
You're into the business of public education, talk shows, you're on radio,
yes.
You do cultural work and so on. Do you think that you've been reaching people real people who these things, these issues that you talk about every day, it matters to? Do you think that you're making some impact?
Today was a bad day. I don't think I reached anybody. They called me today. But sometimes you do. Sometimes you, and it's particularly when you go into the inner city and you sit and you talk with people, then you see that maybe something you did is of some importance. But to think that walk around thinking I've made a change is very dangerous. You could die of overinflated ego. What I think is that each of us who has some sense of the role we can play, have to play it, whether to use the arts to do it, whether it is to use the power that we have in the media. And here, incidentally, there's been a lot of criticism of the media in recent months. People feel that we in the media are too into grandstanding now. We want too much to be part of the story instead of bringing the story. And so maybe I listen to all of that and wonder if in the criticism I could maybe be better than what I am doing now.
Mm-hmm. I read a piece that you wrote in the Air Jamaica magazine, Think Skywriters and Courtney Walsh.
Yes.
And I'm interested in that because you had Courtney Walsh breaking the record in Jamaica. You had Jimmy Adams becoming the captain. And then Wavell Hinds becoming the new
sensation
here in the Caribbean. What is the impact on that on the Jamaican society as you move around? Do you get the sense?
When Walsh wrote that record, it was a tremendous moment. Because, and the thing that people say, as you saw from what I wrote in is Mr. Walsh the gentleman.
Right.
And I think that where we have to begin to look at is the impact on young people. Because I believe there's one generation that you just have to leave alone till time take care of that. And my hope is that all the young people will see that you can be a Courtney Walsh, you can be vigorous and exciting and disciplined, that you can be a Wavell, that you can be all of the other guys with Kendall. And I believe that when I look at the under-19 cricket team, when those guys were receiving their caps, the organizing committee did it at a dinner one night for them at Otter and insisted that every boy have a parent present. Mm-hmm. Your father don't have to be married to your mother. He didn't say that your mother and father and their marriage certificate. Maybe your father's a drayman. He must come there the night. And when they call, whatever it is, your father and your mother, or your father, or your mother, or your granny, or the old lady who bring you, stand up with you. Now that is where I'm seeing hope. Because those boys will never be the same again. Every time they go out onto that field, there's a granny or an uncle or somebody watching them. And I think people like the Walshes and others, Jimmy Adams, having a impact on some young people. Whether it reaches across the critical mass, but you hear people admire them. The man is a decent man. Decent. And the word decent comes out. In this battle, if we can get more people realizing the value of an Adams, the fact that the value of a Walsh, the wonderful story of Walsh, whose mother brought him up, my mother, who fathered me. That is a hope for a woman, a single woman, bringing up a son. I could bring up a Courtney Walsh. But there's another mother we have to talk to, is a mother who washed blood out of gunman clothes. So I speak to her directly sometime and I said, don't do it, because your son will never be a Courtney Walsh. And I think that the thing is incremental. You have to do a little at a time, and we have to stop this letting the world beat on Jamaica. Jamaica is a damn fine country. You understand? But Jamaica is a microcosm of the world. That everything, people who do studies on the diaspora, if you want to study what happened to the people of Africa, Jamaica is a perfect place to study, because all of it is here. All of it is in one small place. Big plantation, what happened through the people who came, how your Spanish took over from, run out the English, having killed up the Arawaks. English gave way to what? American gave way to the whole world. It's all here. But I think that what has happened to us is that we've become contentious and obsessed with our own importance and our failing in our own importance. I think we beat upon ourselves too much. And maybe this is what is when you keep dumping on yourself, then other people take liberty with you.
The rest of us in the Caribbean always see Jamaicans of been very aggressive, very rebellious. Where does that come from?
It's your ancestral thing. We were Ashanti, and soon after we came here, we rebelled. And the whole history of our development has been that rebellion. Taki and Kodjo and everybody who said, look, the first day they came here, I ain't settling for this crap here, so I'm moving on and moving out. In Jamaica was perhaps the most cruel of the plantations. They used to bring slaves from the southern United States to break them here and send them back. And somehow that tradition. But I you see, there's aggression and aggression. Uh-huh. And I think that what I used to love was my in-your-face Jamaicanness. You deal with me as a Jamaican when I come into the room. Mm. What I don't like is that the rest of the world is beating on us and we start beating on ourselves and cringing. I ain't going for that. There was a time when we said, when you march into a meeting, an international meeting, when Jamaica arrived, it still does. I'm on a, this is not in praise of myself, but I'm on a UNESCO commission. And every time Jamaica talk, the room listen. And we're saying the same thing, but it's just the way we say it. And I think that what is perhaps the most dangerous thing of this period is that we have let the combined weight of the natural progression of the world weigh on us, that we're in danger of people seeing us as some sort of aberration rather than a proud people who have worked their way through troubles before. And that is what makes us real. We're real people.
Let me take you back a couple of decades, because
I'm not that old enough. Give us a break there. Yes, yes.
A lot of people have been talking recently about the '70s. The '70s in the Caribbean, the '70s in Jamaica, democratic socialism, everything that came with that. And it seems to me that 20 years later, it's about a good time to really look and to see what was the impact of the '70s.
When it started for the critical mass of people, it offered a lot of hope. For the first time, we had a leader who was saying, get up and say, I can be somebody, that we could be self-reliant, we could grow food. There were farms here growing food to stone dog. People were saying, I am somebody. But much of those somebody were black people, you know. And the unresolved agenda of race in this country is still very much here. It might not be Mason-Dixon line and South Carolina and the rebel flag, but it is still here. And Mr. Mandy failed in not being able to harness that part of the society. He failed also because there were others who set the agenda for his failure. Anybody with any intelligence will tell that happened. But one of the things which people who lived through that thing remember, that for one brief shining of, we were somebody. We could grow our food. We could speak at the UN. We could say that we're going to share things. I remember last night I saw a production by a Trinidad theater company about women and women's issues. And I had to say to them in the after theater discussion, but it was the Jamaican Sistrin Theater Company, a group of women who used to sweep street, who formed themselves into a theater company, which articulated the needs of the society. Sistrin, I can't find them now.
Race. Jamaica is a predominantly black country.
Yeah.
So how to somebody who
brown man.
Talk about how race manifests itself.
It does, because it's still at the lowest level. Some people of color still are obsessed with the fact that they are not as good enough as they should be. So you have the phenomenon of skin bleaching,
right,
and buying 5 kilometers of hair, as if that but then we take it from America when the hair is made. So I think below the surface it is there still is this. I was getting my hair cut somewhere there, and a lady said to me that, oh, she admired what I do and thing, and I should come and speak to her little boy. He's 7 and his sister is brown and he's black, and he keeps saying, Mommy, why didn't have 2 brown children? Because look how my sister is brown and I am black. And if a child of 7 is saying, it's there still, that people still are into this nonsense about the wrapping of the parcel. And whether we want to admit it or not, it is still there. You see it manifested from time to time in advertising, in all kinds of things you do, in beauty contests. Real crappy stuff. And what is worse is that the people in the critical mass will accept this foolishness, which should have been kicked out long ago, and said, if you cannot compete as a person, I love my browning. You know?
Yes. Yeah,
but we take it from America too. When I look look at something on television, on cable, whatever it is. Every black actor, a black thing, have a brown wife.
Yes.
So that you have only a Denzel Washington come out with a black wife, or a Samuel John Scott, or Morgan. Because I even begin to look for those now who will take a wife of the same skin hue. But something is wrong, where we have to begin to quantify people about the amount of melanin in their skin. And it's time we come out and talk about it and say that it's crap and it must stop. And we must take people at who they are and what they are. And a girl could be as dark as ebony. She must be. Have you seen a girl who models for some of the major European house? I think she's some Somali or Mali. She couldn't be blacker. And she's one of the world's greatest models now, because the rest of the world is saying, doesn't matter. What you have is one lovely lass. Mm-hmm. And I think that we in the Caribbean still fool around with it. In the rest of the Caribbean, I worry from what I've seen about the Indian African equation, that I think is something that we'll have to be dealt with one another day, but that's not my fight, you know?
Yes. A lot of people looking at this show from live in North America, Jamaicans living in North America, and people who continue to refer to Jamaica as their homeland and come here, make the pilgrimage here 2-3 times a year these days. And I know a lot of them who want to contribute, who want to do something to help move Jamaica forward. How do you suggest that they can intervene in a real positive way?
The first thing is that they must continue believing in us. And they must acknowledge that we have some terrible flaws, but we still have some tremendous strengths. Because if they don't believe in us, they wash their hand and say, what a violent, ugly, nasty little country. And they sit on the subway on the bus. Jamaica to a whole busload or a carload full of people who were thinking of going to Jamaica on holiday. No amount of money they send down here in the remittance is going to see it. They have to believe in us. They have to understand that there are things in our lives which are not good, just as they are elsewhere. Ours is more concentrated because the space is small and it is happening in a smaller space. But they have to start first by believing in us.
30 seconds, when Barbara Gordon gets up in the morning, what makes you tick?
First I try to walk. And then I say, dear God, I'm alive another day. I don't know, I try to do that. And then I try to sort of say, well, today let me just do the best I can. And if I don't, I try again tomorrow.
I can attest to that. You have done the best that you
Thanks
can here.
Respect.
Wonderful interview.
Respect.
Thank you very much. I'm sure you'll agree with me that this interview with Mrs. Gloudon was very informative and as candid as they come. Until the next time, this is David Hinds thanking you for tuning in to yet another edition of Carib Nation. And remember, as always, our motto here is one people, one culture, one Caribbean, one nation. See you next time.